paper on the floor, I have the Lord in mind. If I'm treated wrong, I try to treat right because I have the Lord on my mind. Okay? And the attitude of a servant is, I plan to please God regardless of how I feel. We have to become servants. We have to become slaves. We are now bound. We have been bought with the price. Do you all hear what I'm saying? We no longer can do what we want to do if we're truly going to be. Now, we can be churchgoers. That's different than what I'm talking about. Being a churchgoer is different than being a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, who wants to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? Who wants to follow the Lord Jesus? Some of you raising your hands kind of like this, you know. Let me see. Make it known. Who wants to be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ? Okay. To be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ means you have to suffer. Means you have to go through some things. Now, when you come to church, and you can fool me. I'm not that hard to fool sometimes. So, yeah, you can fool me. But I'm talking about having a true relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It does not stop. The mindset of a servant is, I have a master who's watching me. And I now have to take my greatness and place it under subjection to one who is greater than I. And see, when we realize that we have someone greater than us, it offers us coverage. Right? Some of the attacks that many of you have gone through in life were meant to take you out. But because you have coverage over your mind, when the enemy has come in and shot his best shot at you, the coverage that was on your mind was able to hold the enemy back because you have confessed that you are a servant. And when you are a servant, it means that you have a master. But see, when you are a free agent, you don't have a master. See, in the natural, well, no one wants to be a slave. But in the spirit, it's good to be a slave because your master knows how to judge fairly. And your master knows how to feed you. And your master knows how to take care of you. And he won't leave you without you being covered. So when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him, will protect you in spite of what's coming against you. And you'll stand on the outside saying, wow, I don't know how I made it through that. And then after you say that for a while, you come to yourself, you say, had it not been for the Lord who was on my side, I surely wouldn't have made it out of this challenge. And God says, now I'm ready to take you to another level. But in order for me to take you to another level, I need you to go down another level. See, the kingdom of God is contrary to the kingdom of this world. See, the kingdom of this world says, get all you can. Get all you can. And after you get all you can, put it on the can, put it in the can, and then sit down on the can. But the kingdom of God teaches us to give. Because it's better to give than it is to receive. It's better to forgive than it is to hold on. See, the kingdom of God is different from this world. And see, we got to make a decision. Either I'm going to be great in this world or I'm going to be great in the kingdom of God. I want to be great in the kingdom of God. But I realize in order to be great in the kingdom of God, I will be mocked in this world. And see, sometimes I've got to go low in this world in order for God to bring me up in his world. But see, if I go low in this world, people will laugh at me and they'll mock me, they'll criticize me, they'll say all manner of evil against me, but I don't mind going low, because when I go low, I know I'm going high, because he promised me that if I humble myself, he will exalt me in due time, and I'm under the controls of a master. I'm a servant, I'm a slave, I'm chained and I'm bound. I can't do what I want to do anymore. There are things in my flesh that I want to do that make sense to me, that would free me in certain areas to do what I want to do, but man, I have decided to be a servant. I have decided that I am a slave. I have decided that Jesus is my master. I have decided to make him Lord. The problem is many people have made him Savior but have not made him Lord. It's good to have a Savior, but when will we make him Lord? Because see, there's a difference between a Savior and a Lord. If you were to run out in the street and someone came and grabbed you and pulled you out of the street and the car missed you, that person has become, in a sense, a savior. But see, when you become a lord, I am totally under your control. You know how the landlord comes on the first of the month to get their money? When they say, man, I let you lay and I let you stay around in my property for 30 days, but now I've come as the landlord of the land and I've come for what belongs to me. And if you don't give me what belongs to me, I can then give you consequences that we don't like. But I'm telling you, when you allow Jesus to now come from moving from being Savior to Lord, now he is in control of your life. You no longer can do what you want to do. You can no longer say what you want to say. You feel like saying it because our flesh is not dead. You feel like going off me. You feel like cursing. You feel like doing some things that are not right. But because you realize that now you are a servant, you place all your authority under one who is greater than you are. I'm great because I'm a servant. I'm not great because I'm all that on earth. I'm great because I'm a servant. I'm great because I have a shepherd, and I will follow after my shepherd wherever he leads me. Sometimes he leads me places that don't feel good. Sometimes he tells me to do things and I take down. And you know what happened? He says, here's another check in the spirit realm. Here's a laugh on earth, but here's a check in the spirit realm. Paul said, listen, let me pull out my checklist because now I must run through my life. He said, I have run the race. Check. I have finished the course. Check. Now it's laid up for me a crown of righteousness. Why? Because I've done what my master had called me to do. I wonder how many servants you have in the house, because once you are a servant, you'll empty yourself. Empty yourself of your greatness. Empty yourself of what you have accomplished. Empty yourself of what you think about yourself. Don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to think, but humble yourself. And as you humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, he promised that he will exalt us. The Bible says this. He said that God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. God will give grace to those that humble themselves in this situation. But now, here lies the problem, because many of us don't like being laughed at in this world. But listen, I'd rather be laughed at and be found true. We got to make a decision now. We got to make it right now. We can't go another moment. I'm going to read when he tells me to read. I'm going to pray when he tells me to pray. I'm going to submit when he tells me to submit, because when I submit, I dump the dots of the enemy. When you stand up, the reason why you're not winning is because the darts are hitting you. But if you learn to submit when the bullets come, you learn to dump, because now I'm under coverage. And one that is greater than me has told me to dump. And when he told me to dump, the attack didn't work. I was able to submit under authority. He said, son, stand up, and now I stand bold and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. He said, son, now submit, and I submit, and the darts fly by, and I can see them fly by, and my mind's still intact, because I'm a slave under the mighty hand of God. And once you become a slave to the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible says, eyes have not seen, ears haven't heard, neither has it entered the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for those that love Him. God is leading us by our spirit, while Satan is trying to lead us by our flesh. Don't you know that he's the God of this world, small g? According to 2 Corinthians 4:4, the Bible says that Satan, the God of this world, has blinded the eyes of them that believe not the gospel, lest the light of this glorious gospel of Jesus Christ is preached unto them. People are walking around blind now. They can't see, and the devil's telling them to build your own kingdom. Call yourself a God. You are a God. What do you need to go to that church for? What is that fake religion that the white man started? The devil is a liar, because God is a spirit. He's not black or white. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Not with my intellect, not my education, not my degree, not who I know. No, no, no. I'm worshiping him in the spirit. You know how you worship in the spirit? You get in a situation that hurts you so bad that all you do is cry out with genuine worship. You don't have to be taught this. The pastor don't need to teach you. Genuine worship comes out of pain when you're hurting so bad and you don't know which way to go. And you've held this facade for too long. You cry, Lord, help me, save me, deliver me, set me free. And God comes through like I didn't know what to say. I don't have to tell you, raise your hands a quarter high, turn around three times, say thank you Jesus twice and hallelujah four times. No, when you hurt so bad, when your back is up against the wall and you see no provision, you see no way out, God said the principles that I taught you in church, I now want you to apply outside of the church, because the storms come when you leave out the door. This is a place for teaching and instruction, but the real attacks come when you leave out of the door, and you have to practice the principles that you learn, because we can't be with each other 24/7, but we've got to write notes down, and we got to plan, and we got to strategize against the enemy. And you know what you say? You know what? I'm humbled in the presence of God. I'm a servant in the presence of God. Oh man, you dumb going down to that church. Here's one for you. Giving all your money and listen to that preacher. You dumb for that. And I don't have a Cadillac, but then you dumb for that. You're doing all those things. You know, all you did. But what the Bible tells me to do, I'm gonna do. And anyone that mistreats me gotta stand before the presence of God. All I need to do is do what God told me to do. I'm not worried about how you handle me, because you know what I found out? God looks at it like this. It's not how you treat me, it's how I treat you. That's what I'm gonna be careful of. I don't have to worry about how you treat me. I gotta look at myself and look at how I treat you, because all I gotta stand for God for is how I treated you. So I don't care about how you treat me. I better be careful how I treat you, because I don't have to stand before God for you. I got to stand before God for me. And he's going to say, why did you say such and such? Because so and so. I don't want to hear that. I told Adam I didn't want to hear that. And I don't want to hear it from you. You are my servant. You go where I tell you to go. You say what I tell you to say. You sit down and duck the ducks when I tell you to. You hold your peace and let me fight the battle. You don't trust me. That's the reason. Listen, when we don't trust God, we move out and do things our own. We move upon our own strength. We move upon our own ability. We do what we want to do when we don't trust God. But man, if we truly trust God, we will lean on the scripture. Don't fight that battle. Let the Lord fight that battle. And if we let the Lord fight that battle, he may take 3 and 4 years to complete it. But we say, you take it too long. No, you don't trust me. If you'll let me win the battle, if I know how much pressure to apply to a person, I know how to discipline them. I'll leave them alone for a season. I'll turn up the heat for a season. I won't speak to them for a season. I know how to get into their minds. I know how to discipline them. Leave them alone. Leave my servant alone. I know how to get to their secret place. You're messing things up with your own mouth. You're messing things up trying to do it yourself. How can we judge another man's servant? Leave people alone. Let them worship God. Let them find their own place in God. And when they find that sweet spot in God, when they worship God and those tears are rolling down their eyes, there's a connection taking place that's greater than anything you and I can do. Leave people alone. Let them worship God. Because when they get to that place, they will be walking with their servant. When the slaves broke free, they began to remember what it felt like being under the controls of the evil master. Even though they were free, they still felt captive. We can be free in Christ and still allow what we've gone through to cause us to believe that we are in bondage when truly we are free. Because sometimes things remind us of when we were in bondage. Some things, some areas smell like when we were in bondage. Some areas have voices that remind us when we were in bondage. But the truth of the matter is, you have now become free because you've become a slave to Jesus Christ.